In a world without women, things get weird. Like, really, really weird. We're taking a quick peek at Lisa.
Uh-huh, let's see here. Ooh. Oh my.
Back in 2013, Dingling Games had a Kickstarter for a game set in a wasteland world filled with drugs, violence, and the decay of human intelligence. And they've mostly delivered on all of those fronts about a year later. Joy, a drug that fills you with artificial happiness, plagues the bloody landscape and its inhabitants slowly but surely lose their minds. In Lisa, you play as Brad. No, the game's not necessarily a misnomer, as Brad randomly finds himself the caretaker for a child, the only and possibly last girl to exist in the entire world. Well, I don't know if the kid's name is actually Lisa or not. She serves as Brad's entire motivation in life, and your motivation in the game, as she has been kidnapped. It's up to you to get her back, and it won't be easy. One of the main things in Lisa is that you aren't really given much of a way in which direction you need to go or what you need to do. Lisa is broken up into two sections, your exploration section and combat section. Exploration takes place from the 2D perspective, not too dissimilar from a platform game, but it doesn't control like one. You can't freely jump around whenever you want to, and you can hop up ledges and climb ropes, but only if they're low enough to reach. You gain the ability to jump over small gaps by finding a little bike to ride around, but exploring has one big issue. Its name's Cliff. Cliff is everywhere, and he is a friggin' jerk. You can only climb ropes or hop up ledges by standing in front of them, and there are many locations that where you need to stand to use these things are right next to cliffs. I found myself accidentally diving off edges multiple times, causing me to instantly get a game over. This wouldn't be so bad if the save system was a bit different. Like a lot of old school RPGs, Lisa uses save points. But they don't really work with the insta-kill death pits. No matter what you do after you save the game, how much progress you made, nor levels you've gained, it's all lost if you die before reaching another checkpoint to save your progress. And with such an easy way to accidentally kill yourself, you can easily lose a lot of time in the game and have to replay a bunch of stuff. Cliffs are a huge nuisance, but they're really the only issue that I have with the exploration parts of the game. I really like how open the game is, since there is a reason to explore just about everything. Just about every nook and cranny has some purpose to exist, be it finding hidden items or people to talk to, and it's a good idea to talk to just about everyone. Many of Lisa's inhabitants have some kind of information or are willing to trade with you for something. Some will even join your quest if the right conditions are met, be that trading with them, saving them, blackmailing them, or listening to them talk. And talk. And talk. Will you just shut up already? I hardly cared what you had to say to start with! Holy crap, some of these people have so much dialogue! None of it's voice acted. Everything in this game is text box, which can make having to read what people have to say a little bit annoying when they have a lot to say. Talking with people and exploring around is also a way to get a great laugh. Lisa is filled with all kinds of ridiculous nonsense and dark humor. It can be both creepy and weird when it wants to be, but most of the game is so ridiculous and over the top, it makes it hard to take any of it seriously. There's plenty of references and parodies of things both new and old, and little bits of dialogue constantly catch me off guard, making me laugh for a few minutes. Not all of the humor is dark humor, some of it's just generally funny, but a good amount of it is, which fits the dark and desolate theme of the game. This means that it's not going to be everybody's kind of humor, or even everybody's kind of game. But I at least found it funny, and I'm always excited whenever I find a new area since I never know what to expect. While exploring, you're going to run into people or things that are going to want to kill you. They can't be helped. Everyone's after supplies, following orders, defending their turf, or out of their freaking minds. Combat is your basic turn-based combat. Well, you tell your party to do stuff, then they do it. Then the enemy does their stuff. It's your turn again to do stuff. Lots of stuff. It's pretty by the books when it comes to turn-based combat, and each party member has their own class and their own way of fighting. I've yet to see any of them really double up on what they do, though a few are kind of similar. One of the main things that stands out is how some of your characters can learn new skills to use. Everyone can learn new things to do just by leveling up, but characters like Brad can also learn them by doing them. His basic attack allows you to create a combo of his attacks, and you can learn skills by inputting their correct combo. This is a great way for players to organically discover new skills through trial and error, and I'm pretty sure there are some powerful things hidden away in all those combos that I haven't found yet. There are other characters who have this ability as well, but they seem to have different combos to discover to unlock different moves. Characters' abilities are also broken up into two categories. Some characters have SP points that start out full and drain as they use them. Other characters have TP points, which start at zero and charge up when that character attacks or takes damage. It's a great way of giving players some strategy, and you are going to need it when it comes to some of the fights you come across. You aren't the only one out there who rolls around with a posse, and while you can only have a max of 4 party members, including Brad, you'll find yourself going up against larger groups and much, much more powerful enemies. Lisa does something interesting with most enemies, though, as a lot of them have their own unique personality, and there are only a couple of areas I've come across so far where you fight the same kind of enemy multiple times. It's also important to fight as much as you can, since unique enemies don't respawn. You can quickly find yourself outclassed against a couple of nutjobs obsessed with their hair. There's only one thing that I don't like about the combat, and that's that there's no indication for how much health whatever you're fighting has left. Many moves can do a couple hundred points of damage, and while some enemies will change as they take more damage, a lot of them don't, and I have to hope I won't get a party wipe before I finish off my opponent. Overall, Lisa is a great game. I've put 6 hours into it so far, including having to restart the game and go through all of the unskippable beginning stuff again due to falling off of a cliff before I reached a save point. But I can easily say that I'll be playing the game more. Even though I've put a good chunk of time into the game, I still feel like there's so much more to do, so much more to see and explore, and I've really only just begun my journey through the land of Lisa. Lisa also makes its players make important decisions that affect the rest of the game. Resting at a campfire will restore your party, but there's a chance that bad things can happen to them while you sleep. Party members could get kidnapped, or you could wake up next to a mugger who will knock you unconscious, permanently damaging your stats, then steal some of your stuff. Your party's lives are also constantly in your hands. If they die in battle, they can be revived, but if they die outside of battle, they're gone for good. Do you make sacrifices to keep them alive, or do you only worry about yourself more than anybody else? The choice is up to you, and there are no takebacks without replaying the game. It adds a great deal of replayability as well as thought when it comes to making decisions, and I completely feel that the game is worth its $10 price. Just be prepared, the game starts out strange and only gets stranger. You can also pick up the game's soundtrack for $6.99, and I wouldn't really recommend doing that. The music in Lisa, even though it's made by Jake Kaufman, and Jake Kaufman's made some great tracks for stuff like Blood Rain Betrayal, as well as Shovel Knight, the music in Lisa, a lot of it's not what I would call music. Some of the tracks are pretty good, but a lot of them are just all over the place and a bit of a mess. Maybe some people would enjoy it, but personally, I think $6.99 is a little bit pricey for what the music is, and there's not many tracks in the game that I necessarily would want to listen to. Well, that's all I got for you guys today. Please let me know what you think of the game or this video in the comment section. I'm Mega Pie Man, and I'll leave you with this poem. Johnny Brightside attacked in a flash. He jumped from his hiding spot in a dash. Wielding 2 knives that didn't quite match, he flailed at what he couldn't see through his eye patch. He had 2 of them, you see, 1 for each eye, and at first I thought I would just walk on by. But as he insisted he would steal my stuff, I decided to inform him that I was quite buff. Through the air I set my fist humming, and Johnny's last words were, "Didn't see it coming." That's one of the problems with Ultra World. It asks its players a lot of questions, but doesn't really give them any great way to answer until the end of the game. Granted that you're interested...